I was born in Sullivan, Indiana, which was that is coal mining country. My dad was a coal miner, plus he farmed a little haul gravel for the county, all at the same time back in, I can remember as a child what he did.
Did the Depression affect your family?
It affected us, but we were farm family. We raised our own food, our own pigs and beef, and mom canned everything, and we wore patched clothes now, but we survived real well, I'd say.
Did you like school?
I liked school. I was especially interested in high school. I loved math, accounting, anything to do with math. That was my forte.
You know, when you walk into a classroom of kids, there's all kinds of personalities. There's the loud kid, the quiet, shy kid, the smart kid, the boisterous kid. If we walked into your classroom, you know, which kid were you?
I was a quiet Todd. Of course, we had to be quiet when I went to school. Not like they are today. But.
You know, when you think back on your childhood, did you like your childhood?
Oh, sure. I had fun. I mean, we had to work, but we still had fun. I can't complain about my childhood.
Tell me about what your situation was when you heard about Pearl Harbor being bombed.
December the 7th? I'd just been married about 3 months. And I already had two brothers been drafted into the service. And so I figured I was going to be drafted sooner or later. So, actually, I didn't hear about it till in the afternoon because my wife and I had been to a dance the night before and were out pretty late. And I think we got up about 2 o'clock in the afternoon, you know. But it was quite a blow. But.
Do you have a sense you were going in the service at some point?
Oh yeah, I knew it was coming sooner or later. Just being that I was married, it just was prolonged a short time.
How is it then you ended up getting in the service?
I was drafted in 1942, right the end of the year. I had to report in December, or late in December, after Christmas. And then I went into the service actually in January of 1943. At Fort Benjamin Harrison, that's where they processed us. And then you want to know where I went from there?
I talk about training and that kind of thing that you went through.
Okay. So, I was there just a short time, then I was sent to Jefferson Barracks, Missouri. Of course, that being in January, along the Mississippi River, basic training, it was cold. It was cold. My wife got to come down there one weekend, and I got off one weekend. I got to see her. After I finished my basic training, it's interesting story. My brothers had told me not to volunteer for anything, but the drill sergeant came out and said, can anybody in the squad here type? I didn't speak up. I'd taken 2 years of typing, so I was. So after he went in back in the office to tell the first sergeant, I followed him in. So I got a, I got the job. I was in there with the first sergeant. I got to go to the mess hall, head of the line, and all that. But the detail clerk, I don't know what his problem was, but he didn't, apparently didn't like me. I don't know why, but the, when I first started working with the first sergeant, I, either that or he was jealous of the fact that I was in there with the first sergeant, he put me on KP. And the first sergeant said, well, you go and report, and then we'll send somebody to come and get you. So they did. And the next day, or shortly after that, I don't remember if it was the next day, put me on detail cleaning officers' quarters. So I went ahead. I didn't even tell the first sergeant that I had to do that. And I was over there helped cleaning the first the officers' quarters. They're messy too. Believe me.
We won't tell them.
And they sent a runner. The first sergeant sent a runner, what they call a runner, to tell, bring me back. And he chewed that guy good. And he never put me on any more detail. Well, I was, I don't know, I think it was about, trying to think when we shipped out.
Can I ask you a question? You know, at this point, just before you shipped out, you're a married guy. What was your mood or your feeling about it at that point? Did you want to go? Did you wish you weren't in the service? Were you glad you were in the service? What was your sense of it?
I think probably had a feeling it was my duty to be in the service. But
did you take a ship over to England?
Yes, it was a USS James Parker. It was a converted freighter, I guess. They had it double loaded, what they call double load, was in a convoy, but they had bunks, I mean, these, they weren't bunks, they were the, what do you call them, those net?
Like a hammock-like?
Yeah, all stacked up down there. Well, I was supposed to go down there the first night, so I went down there the first, that's the last night I ever went down there.
Why is that?
Oh, man. If people got seasick and then everything, and it was stuffy, hot. So I slept up on deck the rest, took us, we was on 11 days in that convoy. We were right in the, I guess, out the middle of it. We had destroyers on the side, on the back, right behind us was a, it wasn't a carrier, but it's just a transport aircraft.
How do you pass the time all those days?
I think probably, if I remember, we played some cards and so forth like that. And it was, I kept really, and I only went down in the mess hall one time too. Went down there and he stood at this table and the things would slide around and so forth. And one time, so we just ate snacks and so forth that we could get a hold of. Apples, oranges. We had, for some reason, they had plenty of those on the ship.
At some point, where did the ship arrive?
Liverpool. From Liverpool, we went to the air base where we were stayed, Framlingham Air Base.
Do you remember what your impression was of Framlingham Base when you first saw it?
Not really. It was, of course, the housing was a lot different than what it was in the States. Some of it was Quonset huts, but the one that we were in was more, it's like a one-story. They had gable roofs and so forth. But
how many people were in the room you were in?
I was in like a 29-man organization, and we were all in that one.
What was it like to be in a room like that with 29 guys?
Well, it's double bunked. I had a good buddy down. I was on the top bunk. He was on the bottom bunk. And if I needed help, he was right there. He's a great guy, Italian, from Oklahoma. And
so friendships were formed.
Yeah, I used to loan money to this about every month to this young man from New York, and if he didn't pay me back on payday like he's supposed to, well, Turk was my buddy. His name was Turkion, T-A-R, I don't know, called him Turk. He would make him pay me on payday. So we had, he and I, one time there's a Jewish holiday, and our first sergeant was actually Jewish, real nice guy. And he and I went up to the, if you're Jewish, you got to pass to get off the base, you know. So we went up and told the first sergeant then, we were, Finkelstein and Goldberg. We told them, Finkelstein and Goldberg was our name. We wanted to pass. Sergeant said, you guys get the, you know, H out of here. He took it all in good faith.
So you didn't get the pass?
No. There's a lot of things happened there. But
share with us some of the things that stand out in your mind. Things that...
You want some of the funny things? Of the things that happened?
We'll try and cover them all, but what are the things that just kind of pop in your mind about being over there?
Well, one time, somebody in our squadron stole the up at the beer place. What was it they called it? I don't remember. A whole barrel of beer. I mean, this was a big wooden barrel of beer. And they rolled it down into the, it was right almost out in front of our quarters there. When we came in from loading bombs that night, there was that barrel with a head knocked out of it. All you had to do was dip your canteen cup in there and get you some beer if you wanted it. Well, anyhow, the commanding officer was Colonel Gimmel. He was from Indianapolis, Indiana, which I'm from Indiana too, but that didn't make any difference. But he confined us to the base for 7 days, the whole squadron. And then at payday, depending on your rank, they took out so much money to pay for that barrel, because they said, dude, that barrel is English. It cost, I think, $90 or something like that. It wasn't, in fact, we had to pay for the beer, it was just the barrel. So we got that done. That's one thing.
You know, let me back up a little bit and tell me, what job did you have on the base?
I was in ammunition ordnance. We were the ones that took care of the bombs.
Take us through a typical day that you had to take care of the bombs. Take us through it, what you would do.
Well, when they trucked them in, we had to stack them. They were stacked, 500 pounds were in this row, and 1,000 pounds were in this row, or 100 pounds or 250 pounds, they were in different, we had to stack those. And then when they had about every night, of course we had a mission, but we had to load those on trailers, bomb trailers. They had channels that they slide them on, and take them to the plane.
Would it be dark when you're doing this?
Oh, yes, yes. We loaded at night because they flew out early in the morning, real early in the morning. It's generally dark when they start taking off for Europe. We'd take them out to the plane, and back to load the loaded trailer in between the bomb bay doors, and then the armament people would load them with either with a hoist, or if they were small enough, they'd just lift them up. But normally, they with the big larger bombs, they had to use a hoist to hoist them up. And they fused them too.
Was it? You know, these are bombs. Was this, you know, dangerous work?
No, the bombs weren't dangerous till they were fused. I mean, they were either TNT or RDX, and actually, some of them, they just come in there and back the truck up and then put the brakes on, they roll out, you know, on the ground. The only dangerous part I had, when they used delay fuses, that was like, if they could drop them, they might go off in so many hours, you know, they wouldn't go off instantaneously. Well, I think I only had to do two loads, but those fuses were made so if you screw them in, and if you hit a bad thread or something, you couldn't back it off, because they had a, if you started backing it off, it would separate, and there's a I mean, like a ball bearing that, that would catch it. I don't know what. That was a little bit scary if you got hit a thread that didn't go very good, and so forth. But my lieutenant always put me on that job. But I think he was a little guy just like me. I think that's the reason why we got along so well. But he trusted me, which I always appreciated. But in fact, he wanted me to go to bomb disposal school with him up in Scotland. He says he was first lieutenant. He said I'd make captain, and I was a three-stripe sergeant. He said I would make master sergeant. I said no way. I wasn't.
Why didn't you want to be a master sergeant?
I didn't want to be in bomb disposal. The master sergeant sounded good.
Yeah, the bombs were better when they weren't fused, huh?
Oh yeah. I wasn't afraid of them then, but I wasn't. Well, if you didn't bomb disposal, you would have to contend with German bombs and American too, you know. In Germans, you didn't. Be hard to know what the fusing was and so forth.
So you stayed where you were.
Yeah. Another story. I fell out of the bomb bay. And lived, you know. It was on the ground. But the bomb bay doors had been open all night, and I was going. It's just a little catwalk you can go. If you ever seen the B-17 catwalk.
And right over the bomb bay doors, right?
It's right down the middle of the bomb bay. And they had the doors open all night. Apparently there was dew on there. And I was going across there and slipped, fell and hit something on the bomb bay door and broke some ribs. It was painful. Can I tell you this story? Mm-hmm. Okay. Anyhow, this our tech sergeant was from Montana. I got to tell you, he was filthy, dirty. I don't know if he ever took a shower. And he would lay up in a hut that we had out there at the bomb dump and sleep while we were loading bombs. And anyhow, when I got hurt, he told the staff sergeant that he couldn't take the bomb truck off the base, off the airfield, to take me to the base hospital. Well, the staff sergeant just ignored him. He took me down there. They taped me up, and that was all they could do for me.
How long was it before you were kind of physically right after that?
I was still working all right. I was a crew, what you call a crew chief I had my own bomb truck, my own bomb trailer, and then I had guys down working with me and for me. So I didn't really have to lift anything if I didn't have to, but I always did if, as long as I was able.
How often was it a 5 day a week job, or was it?
It was a 7 day a week job. It was seven. We didn't have no holidays, no. I mean, we did get weekend passes now and then. You had to. Ever so often, when we'd go to London or wherever we wanted to go.
What was it like in wartime London?
It was times it was very dangerous, but one time they was having it, I was at night, and they was having an air raid. Well, I'd been to the pub, you know, like good soldiers do. And I was standing out in the middle of the street, here the English were. Am I getting out of view now and then? The English were shooting, and there's black falling. No, I wasn't paying any attention to it. And there's an English couple came out, got a hold of me, put me in the doorway there. Getting stupid American, I guess they probably thought.
Just from the pieces of flak that were coming down?
Yeah, coming down. Yeah, they're clattering on the street. And apparently, that's what they said, anyhow. So. One time I was in the south end of London, and boy, they started blowing that, you know, they started blowing that place up. And I was with a friend of mine. I was by myself. He had a girlfriend with him. And I said, AF, they call him AF Brown, Air Force Brown. I said, I'm going to the underground. So I went to the underground. He followed, so thank God. He was a flyer, but he always liked to come down to our barracks, and he was a friend of everybody down there. And I don't know why he picked us out, but anyhow, he got shot down and over in Belgium, and eventually the underground got him out, and he came back to England, and he could have came home, but he wanted to stay, and there's an opening in our little 29 man. He stayed with us. I mean, he stayed and worked with us there. So
was that typical, that kind of commitment and patriotism?
I don't. You know, a lot of the officers came down to our day, what they call a day center, and where they had a pool table and so forth, and with enlisted men down. They appreciated the ground crew. I mean, people think of the flyers, but they don't realize the flyers couldn't fly without the ground crew. No. I mean, they couldn't fly without the engineers the ordnance, any of us, you know.
Did you feel appreciated at the time?
Oh, I think we did. I mean, we were treated well, but I think the feeling, I don't know, even then, I don't, of course, there's not very many ground crew come to these reunions. I know one year they did kind of honor the ground crews at the reunion. But normally it's all about, the flyers have got the big stories, you know, that's the...
Did you ever have a desire to go up in one of those B-17s?
Oh, I used to go on practice mission with them once in a while, just...
What was your sense of that? What was that like?
I tell you, I went up one time, and this pilot started rocking that plane. I think I was in the radio room, and he called up to the pilot after so long a time, and he said, I think Smitty's had enough, you know. He knew I was a kind of a greenhorn at the flying, you know. But I went up, as long as you got a parachute, well, you could, they'd let you go on a practice flight. They might go out a little ways over the North Sea, and but of course they wouldn't get out of.
Did you get to know the flyers, any crew members? Was there a kind of any relationship or anything of that sort?
Well, they changed so much. I mean, we didn't really have a chance to meet them. We did our work at night, and and we didn't really know who was flying what plane. But I forgot to tell you, toward the end of the war, they put me, I was taking care of the body armor. I had to check all of our airplanes in our squadron, had to check every position to see if this piece was there and this piece was there, if some of it might be damaged, needed replaced, and so forth. And that's, and I tell my daughter last night, I said, when I was going through some stuff that I'd brought back, I ran across an envelope, and I had these aircraft numbers on here, and I had the positions, I'd had them where I'd been checking them. I said, I had no idea why I had an envelope and kept it with that.
When you say checking body armor on there, exactly what is that?
That's a black equipment. It might be go cover their chest or back if they were
in flak jackets, like,
yeah, their seat the pilot, co-pilot, of course, sitting down. They had underneath them, depending on the position in the plane, what they had.
It's almost like your relationship was more with the plane than it was with the crews.
You're exactly right.
How were there times that, you know, you were aware that planes went out, but those planes didn't come back?
Yes, very aware.
What was your sense, or, you know, how do you handle that?
Well, biggest part of wondering if somebody we knew was on that plane, you know. That of course, this one young man came into our outfit. He was a turret, ball turret gunner under the LA turret. He was from Williamsburg, Indiana, where I graduated from high school. And I knew him. In fact, I'd worked on a farm for his dad. So he told me if he ever came up missing, I could have his what they call suntans. That's a summer. See, they didn't issue us summer clothes over there, over in England. They said because the British didn't have summer clothes, they didn't issue us. Now the officers, of course, they had their own. They could bought their own with their allowance or whatever they got, clothing allowance. Well, anyhow, he got in. Either they went down on a plane, or the plane below them came up and cut. Well, he died in that. It was in Belgium.
Was this a collision?
Yes. Mm. Yes. It wasn't through the enemy fire. It was, he died. Of course, I didn't go get it. I couldn't bear to go get his clothes, but of course, his family then wrote and warned me. I couldn't tell them how he died. I couldn't tell them. No, all of our mail was censored. I don't know whether you ever saw one of those V-mail letters, just little
tissue things.
There's photocopied, really, and they were, every one, they read them. I mean, if there's something they didn't like in there, it's all blacked out. So I couldn't tell them. But there was a nice story about that. They had quite a, in our newsletters or whatever they call it, that the, well, the museum puts out one, and then you've probably seen, have you seen them? That told all about this and mentioned his name and so forth. So I made copies of that. There's several pages of it. In fact, they got a memorial over there where whatever country they went down in. I'm sorry, I don't. And I had copied it for his sister so they'd know after all these years. And,
let me ask you a question. While you were on the base, did you ever have V-1 rockets going over, buzz bombs?
Oh, yes.
What was that like?
That, you were laying in your bunk or whatever, and you hear them, you know. Then when you hear that motor cut off, where's it going to fall? Of course, when that quit, that's when they went down. There was only one came real close to, one came just not too far from the bomb dump out there one night. Yeah, you could see them. They'd be shooting fire coming right over. We'd be out there loading bombs. Here, these things would come.
Were they loud? Or?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, you could hear them for a good ways.
The base never came under attack while you were there.
Oh, yes, it did.
How? Tell us about that.
They shot down the Germans probably then. Nobody's told you this?
We're relying on you.
they it's what they call a pathfinder. With radar was coming in one time, and the Germans followed it, shot it down right at the end of our runways there at the air base. Yeah, and they. There's other, they had, we had some anti-aircraft guns out, manned by Americans, but they couldn't shoot them unless they got permission from the British. That was, I mean, that political, that should never been. In fact, they could have shot the plane down, because it went right over them. I don't know, they dropped some personnel bombs. I guess they were like butterfly bombs, I think they called them. And they were dangerous, I guess. Personnel, they like you walking through the field and you step on one and go off, or well, I don't know. I never saw them, but. This emergency field, which had, golly, I don't know how long, wide that runway was. I mean, it was enormous. And then they had gas pipes around that they could set fire all down through the air. So if it's fog, it'd lift fog. So if the plane got in trouble, well, they could land there. Well, I was on detached service. We were getting ready to load war weary planes that had been stripped down and use them as a huge bomb, really. So, well, anyhow, we was there a short time. We done some, I don't know, I couldn't recall what kind of training we might have been. I remember the English would come out and take us to their mess hall for tea. They'd send a bus out. I mean, we had to go have tea with them. And
did that strike you as strange?
Yeah. Well, see, at our base, the English actually, they came around with a truck that had tea on it. You could buy a cup of tea, I think, for about a penny or something. I don't know. And they realized. Anyhow, one night there was a German plane landed there while we were there. And they put a cover over it. And they got us together, put us on a B-17 that's all stripped down, sent us up to another air base up in Firstfield, England, which I don't know how far away it was. And it had a crazy pilot, but I guess he'd been shot down over in Europe, but got back, and he took off and buzzed the control tower in a B-17. We're flying, scaring chickens. He's flying that low all the way to First Fielding, scaring chicken, cows, horses, and all. You can see them. Anyhow, what we did there was load these B-17s that were stripped down with explosive. I forget what the explosive was. It's in wooden boxes. And then they would take off. But when they got close to the coast, the North Sea, the pilot and the co-pilot would bail out, and then a mothership took over. They had it fixed up a radio control, and then they'd send them over to Germany. And when the mothership let them go, it's a huge bomb.
So it was radio operated, sort of that B-17?
Yes, then it would have been, after they bailed out, yeah.
So they just turned it into a giant bomb at that
right, point. Right, a missile, yeah, well, whatever you want to call it. And do you recall Joe Kennedy getting blown up? Myself and some other guys loaded his airplane. It's a B-24. They call it, and he's Navy. They call it PBY something, but I don't know what the Navy called. But it's just like our Army B-24. Well, I met him. He gave me. I think it's a pound, or maybe a pound, which is equal, it was equal to $4 at that time, and that told me to buy the crew beer, you know, and so forth, treat them. And then, I don't know where's the next day. they were, they got blown up before they got bailed out.
Was there talk about why it blew up prematurely before the crew could get out?
No. I think they were using electric fuses, and I always have a suspicion that something went wrong with their electrical part. I don't know. I wasn't allowed to say a thing. They told me if I ever breathed a word, I would be court-martialed, you know. So they shut the operation down after that. I mean, the Army did too. I mean, they didn't want any more. I got back to the base, they said that General Doolittle had been there. I said, I knew why he'd been there, because it was close to our base where that plane blew out, you know. But I couldn't say anything. I never mentioned that, not even to my wife or kids, till in, I think it's Life magazine, came out with a story about it. Not about me, or then it's about Joe Kennedy. And so then I...
Was there, do you remember, there was at the time that happened, when in Joe Kennedy's plane blew up, was there sort of talk among the crew, scuttlebutt, or, you know, as far as what do you think happened, you know, that kind of thing?
I don't know. I have no idea.
You weren't talking to others?
I couldn't say a word.
I mean, even others that perhaps were involved in it or that you worked with up there.
Of course, I don't know where all those people were from. I wasn't, I think I was the only one from our squadron that was involved in that. As far as I can remember, I was. So then I let the story out, and my wife, I think, notified our local paper, and they interviewed me and wrote up a big story about it. And one of the guy from Richmond that was a flyer, he'd been there and he knew. And when he read that story, I was working at the in the Wayne County courthouse and in an office there, and he came over to see me, and he was very interested in what I had to tell him. Larry Harrison, he's passed on now, but no, I didn't. I was afraid to say anything for years. I mean, it was years. It was, golly, I don't know how many years was it? I got a copy of that at home, but I don't know that paper, but...
Was it sort of hush-hush because it was a secret program and or it was
right.
Joe Kennedy?
Right, it's because it was a secret program. That was...
Did you know who Joe Kennedy was when you met him?
Did I?
In the sense that he was the son of the former ambassador to the British, to England.
Oh, yeah, I knew. Mm-hmm.
Were you able to stay in touch with your wife during your time over there?
Just by letter. Now these people over there, they email and everything, talk to them on their cell phones, and we couldn't even, you couldn't even phone call home.
How long were you over there in England?
I was there from August of 1943, we started flying back in June of 1945. We took off from the base, went to Wales.
Were you flying? Are you in a ship or are you flying?
Flying. They brought the planes back to the United States. So the crew plus 10 ground crew or other people could, and I flew back with them. I had volunteered them because I wanted to get home. Anyhow, we stayed in Wales. I don't know. I think we holed up there for a day, maybe for weather. I'm not sure. Then we flew from Wales to Iceland. It started storming there, and we were there for 4 days. I had to pull guard duty on a plane one night. It was raining, wind was blowing. The ailerons were locked. The plane was all chocked and down, but those ailerons were just flapping in the wind. It was that strong. And the rain was coming in every little crack that there was in the plane.
You're doing guard duty. Are you in the plane?
In the plane. Mm-hmm. In the plane, right. It could get real windy up there. In fact, they're Quonset huts. They had dirt mounded up around them, plus cables over the top that apparently had buried, I don't know. I think they call them dead men, isn't it? Well, there's a load of beer came in there on a ship. I can tell you this, I guess. I don't know where I was, but they came to ask guys to help unload the trucks when they brought the beer up to the base. They put it in another hut. They give them a case of beer. When I went. Went into our barracks that night. There's beer cases lined up all around that. I don't know whatever happened to it. I never got any. I never wanted any of it. Then after 4 days, we flew out of there, flew into Labrador, stayed there overnight, and landed in the States at Bradley Field, Connecticut, July the 4th of 1945.
What was the homecoming like?
Oh, wonderful, wonderful. It was wonderful even in Iceland. I mean, because we got white bread. We ate it like cake, you know, because we'd been eating that English bread, real, I don't know, coarse and made with fish oil, and it wasn't tasty at all. They had ice cream that we hadn't had, and fresh milk. The Air Transport Command would fly fresh milk and all in there every day, every Iceland. And when I got into Bradley Field, I got me a six pack of beer, sat out on the grass and drank it all.
Welcome home.
Welcome home. Yeah. Then they moved us to Massachusetts someplace. What I need to tell you too. When we had to line up, we could call home. And they'd call your name, you got on the phone. When I got on the phone, they rang Richmond, Virginia. I let out with some profanity. I got dressed down. It wasn't my fault. I hadn't seen my wife or talked tour for 2 years or more. And here this operator ring Richmond, Virginia, and it was supposed to be in Richmond, Indiana. Well, anyhow, she finally rang the right number. But
you eventually got through?
Right. It went sent us to Massachusetts and put us right across from the WAC area. I think these WACs were teasing us. They'd walk, we could look right straight through their barracks, you know. They had a fence around, but you couldn't get in there. They'd walk down that through there with their, just in their panties and bra, you know. Well, me and my buddy was walking, strolling, and past their mess hall. One of them yelled at us, "Come on in. Come on and get something to eat." I said, "Well, what will a mess sergeant say about that?" "Well, she likes men too, you know." We just went in and had something to eat and so forth. But no problem. I was married. He was single, but there wasn't anything. But that was interesting. But I know those girls over there were.
At your age now, uh-huh. The life experience you've got now, when you look at that young guy that went over there, how were you different when you came back?
I don't know. I went back to work where I just picked up life like I never had, then I guess like there hadn't been a period of time where it was different, but
are you proud of your time in service?
Oh sure. I'm proud of our outfit. I think we must have the Grievous B-17 outfit. I mean, during the war and after the war, Colonel Mahler really made this what it really is. The museum out there and all, I mean, but there isn't another, nobody else has a museum here.